you want to take it, or?
Sure. I guess welcome to the Blind Sense Podcast.
The first ever Blind Sense Podcast.
Yeah.
Character creation episode, if you will. Now, a warning to you folks up front, there may be from time to time strong language in this, and we don't know if we're yet going to put a kiddie safe version out there too. We'll certainly mark it if we do. But just know that we're not going to be dropping F-bombs just for fun. Well, I might drop them for fun.
me as well. But it's not going to be
we're not going to shock you on purpose.
We're not going to F every other word or nothing. So. Yeah. And only when it really needs to be said that way, but yes.
And for the sake of our stories, try to stick to just first names of friends only to keep from embarrassing or letting weird internet people hunt them down for no apparent reason.
Yes, that is a possibility.
So, one of the first things I think we need to touch on, Mike, is that you're a blind guy.
Yep, I am a blind guy. Woohoo!
All right, you got the medal.
Yes, I did.
But that's why we're going with the Blind Sense name on it now.
Moniker slash whatever, yeah.
Yeah. Now, Mike, you weren't blind when you first found out about D&D, right?
No, I was 8 years old and fresh out of, I don't know, not diapers, but you know.
Jeez. 8. I don't think I even heard about D&D by the time I was 8 years old. I was at least 10, approaching my teens. And I was one of those guys who heard about it where it's like, I hear if you play D&D, you'll be corrupted by the devil.
The devil! Yes. Yes, the devil.
I don't think my mom had ever heard
of it. I was even before that, so. That was the 80s. This was before they really knew about D&D, so.
Yeah, I was born mid-80s, so I'm a 90s kid. How does this work? You people who label me millennial, why you label me? You label me and you negate me.
See, I consider myself an 80s kid because I was born in 1970, but you know what I mean? Because I grew up, that's when all the fun stuff happened, was in the 80s, you know what I mean? So.
See, I'm 85. I was, you know, I apparently just, you know, in time to catch it ending.
Well, yeah. But you were still worried about Sesame Street in the 80s, so. Or, I don't know, whatever.
Mr. Rogers is a really cool guy. You don't understand.
I was worried about who I was taking to the prom at around the time you were still running out of diapers, so.
I came from the background where nobody in my family knew anything about D&D. I didn't have any cool older brothers or anything to teach it to me, no cousins. Right. So, like, we just heard the rumors of, like, I think you can trace it back to Jack Chick was the guy's name.
Yes.
Who did that, like, Satanist comic. It's like D&D. To actually see it
Deadly
now.
Deadly something or others, but yes.
To actually see it now.
It's ridiculous.
Oh, yes. Man.
It was so ridiculous even back then, and I didn't really know much about, you know what I mean?
You know what? You do really well at D&D, and then somebody will come and make you a wizard of grand corrupted. Like, that's basically Last Starfighter's plot right there, is play the game good enough.
Yeah, pretty much.
You're
yeah.
the hero.
Except for in Jack Chick's world. Play the game good enough and you're evil! Evil!
Says you.
Yes, yes. Well, not no, says him, not me. I just say I'm good at the game.
So, when was your first time that you ever actually, you know, rolled a character? And
I got eight-ish. So, damn. Pretty much that's first time I ever heard of the game was the first time I played it, so.
Damn.
See, my cousin had got it for, I don't know if it was a birthday or Christmas or whatever. He got, I think it was the white box, if I remember correctly. So that's why I started on the white box, which is, I think, is the second version. The first one I ever bought myself was red box, so, which was 3 or 4 years later, so.
See, I had some high school friends that played second edition, but, you know, like, I was never part of those groups. So, like, I'd hear the stories and say, oh, man, I wish I could play. And it wasn't actually until college, sadly enough, it was sophomore year till I finally rolled up a character for the first time.
Right.
And one of our mutual friends, Eric, he was the one to actually, I found somebody who knew how to DM. Because you'd find a ton of people on campus that talk about Dungeons and Dragons, but nobody knew how to run a game.
Well, yeah.
Well, I hadn't talked to you about it because, like,
we... Even some of the people that claim to know how to run the games don't know how to run the games. As far as I'm concerned.
And we're going to get so much hate mail at the end of this episode just for that.
That's fine. That's fine. I will answer all the hate mail if they really want to send it to me.
Yeah, right.
Well, you know, it's usually going to be with the big old bird in the air, but, you know. Because I just, yeah. Everybody plays the game their own way. Absolutely. I happen to think there's a right way. Now, you may not find the same opinion, and that's fine. You know what I mean?
Sure. And we've even been playing together, and my way's like, oh, this would be fun or funny. So that's what I'll do. But I remember...
Oh, yeah, exactly. Well, it's as long as you're entertained in the game, that's the whole point. It doesn't matter. Statistics don't matter. As long as you're having fun, that is the main point of the game. You know, and for me, the whole fun part is, you know, getting together with my friends and doing a bunch of crazy shit, you know?
So, well, there are those days where we do get together. Like, my goal is to, what's the most wrong fun we can have with it? Like,
The most inappropriate joke? We do that a lot. We do that a lot. We definitely have the sick sense of humor going when we're playing D&D most of the time. Or, well, actually, Pathfinder, because... We don't play D&D anymore, but yeah.
No, that's we'll get to that in turn.
Yes.
But whenever I started out, it was on 3.5, so I came late to the party.
Right.
And it was Eric DMing and one of my friends from high school, Jeremy followed me to...
No Jeremy.
Camp. Yeah, we all know Jeremy.
We all went to school with him, unfortunately.
Easy now.
I know.
Down boy.
Sorry, Jeremy.
He's
not, I'm just teasing you, big guy.
He's not really. He's not sorry at all.
Well, some days I am, some days I'm not.
I know what you mean.
I might regret it later, but right at the moment, we're fine.
Dude, I actually said to him before, it's like, man, because there's times, like, I'm human. I get really mad. I say things I don't mean.
Mm-hmm.
And I've said,
everybody,
like,
does.
Dude, I was going to totally apologize to you, but then you just said something to me that I'm not sorry anymore.
Mm-hmm.
How's that for an apology, folks?
Yeah, backhanded.
But awesome. getting back on topic, whenever we were gaming with Eric... he had set up this campaign, and there was one other guy, Dusty, who just lived on the same floor of the residence hall with us.
Vaguely remember that kid.
And, we got together and started gaming, and I decided my character concept, I did not know about bards yet.
Right.
I was going to roll myself together a thief, because I like the trap finding, the utility.
A.K.A. rogue, but yes.
But, yes, you're right.
Well, thief-type character with the rogue class.
Here's the secret. I've been in your rum. Now the people at home know.
Well, yeah, rum does that. I've been in my rum, too, but yeah.
But we were creating characters for that, and my whole concept was... I'm going to try and be, like, heavy on bluff. I'm going to try and swindle people, you know, because I'm a really...
Try to talk your way into and out of stuff, yes.
Yep. And my whole thing was I was trying to claim I was a noble who was deposed from my kingdom and was trying to get it back.
Now I remember that story, yes. That was a good one.
And Jeremy, just he was a cleric or some such.
I don't know, honestly.
He was... Oh, I believe him. I don't even roll to check.
Oh, yeah. I remember that part, yeah.
And Dusty was doing his own thing, which was rough for me, because, like, I don't know the character types yet. So we start out looking for kobolds, which
kobolds.
Is a thing to do. Low kobold.
Yeah. Kobold.
To do low level. And he's... You know, he's the ranger, so he's telling us all about what kobolds are, and he's giving us all fake information.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm trying to figure out, like, is he telling me the truth, or is he like, what's going on? He's saying, like, they're 7 foot tall, and they're covered in hair, and all this. So we capture one. Jeremy was obsessed with having a net. So he throws a net over this kobold, and then he kept just swearing to us up and down it had to be a child. It was too small to be anything else. It's a child. You're a child. And then, you know, later on, he thought it was funny to go, you're not a child, are you?
Oh, of things that go through people's heads when they're playing.
So that was one of my first.
Right.
But that brings me to later on when I discovered bards, which brings up my next question on our list, which was, what's your favorite kind of character class to be playing usually?
Me, myself?
Yeah.
I like wizardy types, or, you know, arcane. I like the blasters. I know people are going to say, blasters is the worst way to go ever. Well, screw you. I like them. You know, they're not as ineffective as you people think they are. But, yeah. You just got to know how to do them. Just like anything. Well, I mean, hey, maybe the other way is more effective, but I don't like doing that. So it's not as effective for me. So, yeah. You know.
Yeah, I hear you there. Like, one of my... Eric started, he's like, maybe you should try a bard, man. And I didn't really know how to build one at first. And
right.
And those of you at home who are at all fans of Brian Clevenger and 8-Bit Theater will probably know Twinkin' Out with Red Mage. And the segment that he did at one point in time where he's like, build me the best bard you can. And that's where I came up with, I found out about, rather.
Right.
People who'd come up with the very bluff-heavy, high charisma bard.
You can do some crazy shit with a bard.
Oh, as soon as I tried that, I was hooked.
I don't recall you ever not playing a bard, so there you go.
Oh, there's been times,
but not often. Well, I mean, you've played a bard and another character in the same party with one of my, you did your ranger guy plus the bard.
Yes, that was one of the more reasonable. Oddly enough.
Oh, actually, Mesmerist, you're playing the Mesmerist in the current campaign. So yes. There you go. That's the only,
Oddly enough, though, when we started out with those two characters together,
You hated the ranger.
Yeah, yep. I hated him, and from core cons, I made
He's my little goody two-shoes, and yep. I'm not going to like him. And yep. then, by the end of the campaign, you were in love with... Enjoyed his character.
Pretty close, though. Like, he was originally a concept for just a meat shield.
Right.
And I actually had the internal conflict was supposed to be that he and the bard character didn't like each other.
Mm-hmm.
But as it played out, like, they're early on... You know, they got forced together that I had to have the bard help save him.
Right.
So there was I couldn't have that conflict be rational. So it just kind of built from there. And I remember he helped take down the final boss. And it's like, and it's at that point I said to you guys, it's like, wow, I love this guy.
Yeah. Well, sometimes I play classes. I'm not sure if I'm going to like them and... Then I just, as I develop the character, I start enjoying the character more and more, even though it's something completely different from what I normally play.
Is there any particular thing that makes you want to play the Master Blaster Wizards, though? Like,
I just like explosions, I suppose. You know, fighter likes swords, I like explosions. And I like the flashier type of magic. I just, you know, I'm used to Raceland. I mean, which anybody... who's ever been a D&D fan knows Dragonlance, but, I don't know.
I know of Dragonlance. I have friends who tell me constantly of the exploits that happened in Dragonlance.
Yeah.
And that's definitely a series I still need
Mood
to pick
at
up.
A Minotaur. Yep.
Uncle Tass.
Yeah.
But, I know I like to play bards because, one of the first things for it whenever I started... reading into the high charisma was it's like, so you're saying I can play a character who is like me if I had super high sex appeal and could just talk to anybody and get them to immediately like me. I kind of like that concept.
Well, with wizards, I like knowing everything and they got so many knowledge skills and stuff that I just, you know.
And that's one of the things we were discussing earlier is like with bards, if I had built them right, I could be a master of knowledge, but I tend to be on the more manipulating people instead of knowing stuff spectrum.
Well, you know, yeah, that's exactly. Well, I don't know. Like I said, I like wizards for certain things. Heck, I even like fighters for things that, you know, oh no, he likes a fighter. He's wrong. No.
Is there anything particular? Because I know I find playing the bards. Liberating. Do you find it liberating playing the blaster wizards at all? Like...
I don't know if it's necessary to call it liberating. I just, that's what I enjoy. So, you know what I mean? I've always been a fan of wizards. I've always loved Gandalf. I've always liked Riesling. Those type of characters. So, no, I do not like Harry Potter. Thank you very much. That is not a wizard. That's a pansy. But, yeah.
Not even weighing in on that one.
It's a great series for children. Yes. And I do stress children because anybody with an IQ over 35 should not be reading that stuff.
Full disclosure for you, Mike, I don't think I even ever told you this before, is I had there was a benefit thing that we were doing for one Halloween where we were doing a haunted, in quotes, cave, but it was Harry Potter theme. And I actually played Harry Potter in high school.
Really?
I was in drama, by the way, folks. I used to do acting, and I really enjoyed it. And I think that's one of the things I really enjoy about the bards is, like, the rest of the crew, whenever we're gaming, doesn't seem to really like interaction as much as I do. But I thrive off it. Because, like, from the time of when I was gaming with Eric and the fun that we had in those campaigns, the most fun I had was I'm going to push Eric, see if I can finally get him to say no more. I'm not gonna let you do that.
Yeah, he didn't do that very much. He said a lot more no to Doug than he ever said to you, I think.
Yeah. Well, Doug also pushed his buttons.
Doug went out of his way. He'd pull stuff out of books that Eric never heard of, and you know, like, what was it? Something. The Book of Erotic Fantasy. He pulled something out of there, but he didn't tell him it was the Book of Erotic Fantasy because he'd automatically say no. He just said, oh, yeah, I found it in this book, and it was pretty cool. And he showed him the stuff, and he's like, that ain't bad. And he let him in it, but it was. But if he would have said exactly what it was from the get-go, it would never happen.
That also, not safe for work, not safe for kids, Book of Erotic Fantasy. But that's,
yeah. That book was weird, people. No, there was a couple interesting things in it, but overall, it really wasn't worth it, honestly, in my opinion. Now, people may say differently, but yeah,
I will give you interesting in concept, but,
just the sum of the spells. Prismatic dildo. I mean, come on.
We're up against it now, folks.
Well, hey, if we're going to do it, we might as well break it now. That's what I'm saying.
I guess.
Break it, fix it later, you know?
Busting balls. I remember the Azure balls, and I'm like, really? Really?
Well, is it sort of like Benoit balls or something?
No, the Azure balls was their fake blue balls syndrome.
Azure, like as in blue.
Yeah, okay, gotcha. Yeah, because I'm like, oh, really? You're going, okay, whatever.
Just call them blue balls. Why do you have to go fancy?
Because they added some weirdness in there, too. If I'm remembering correctly, like, it could actually cause paralysis in you for a brief period of time. And then they wrote this ridiculous thing where it's like, oh, well, hookers down by the pier in this one town, when you know, they'd give you the Azure balls and take your coin purse from you. Not that coin purse.
No, it should, you know, okay, paralyzed? No, that's even too ridiculous. Okay, maybe sickened because, or whatever, because you're having problems moving around because, you know, I've had blue balls before and it's not fun. But, you know, it's just whatever. I probably shouldn't say that, but you know, hey. I decided this was going to be an adult podcast in there.
Yes, we've just now decided that, clearly.
No, we did not. We did this before, but you know. It's all good.
Well, if we were going to change our mind, it's beyond going back now.
Nah, yeah, screw it.
But that freaking creative. No. And I understand why Eric blacklisted that book.
Well, yeah. I understand why he blacklisted a lot of things that Doug tried to pull off. Because, like you said, Doug was just trying to get away. Well, I don't know. Doug, I've never had a problem with Doug doing anything in our, you know, in any of our campaigns. It's like, just warn me beforehand, you know what I mean? So I can prepare for it.
Well, and that's one of the things, like, we shouldn't mischaracterize Doug.
Also,
here.
Because I let him do it, he doesn't go as crazy with it either. You know what I mean?
Well, we shouldn't mischaracterize Doug here because, like, I know he's probably listening to this.
Well, maybe.
Maybe.
If he has time between work and kids and stuff.
Come on, it's an audio podcast. Doug,
that's a good point. Yeah,
you have time.
To it in
you
the
can
car.
Listen to this. But no, it's like he took no for an answer usually really well, unless he wanted to push Eric on something. Like Demonic Campaign was our go-to. He played this big praying mantis looking character,
yeah,
Chicklet, and he was so obsessed with grafting wings onto himself, and Eric kept saying no. It's like, if I do, and he kept joking with him, is like, if I do this, will I get a flight speed? No.
Well, because, you know, four-armed, basically praying mantis, you know, what are you going to do? Quad-wielding bastard swords, as he's all used to say, but yeah.
Well, which, he also used to say, it's time to kill shit.
Yeah, kill shit. Yeah, yeah. So he sounded like Beavis or Butthead, one of the two. I think that was Beavis, right?
Yep.
Yeah. He's so definitely. He talked like Beavis. Ah, kill shit all the time, and yeah. But quad-wielding bastard swords was, you know.
But no, and Eric let me get away with a lot, too, because I really enjoyed...
He let me get away with a few things, but I didn't try to push him too much.
But so many scenarios, like one of my favorites from Demonic Campaign, again, where, we were all gaming together, and I got to convince a Garistro that we had killed his boss. And,
and sold him the medal.
You know, he gave me more fair of a chance than he should have, because a Garistro, by the way, as was described to me, is like, think Minotaur, but like two stories tall.
And dumb as a box of rocks, yes.
And it comes up to me and I'm telling him that we just killed his boss, which was a momentous...
which, by the way, was Grazit. Yeah.
I was trying to leave that out because then the audience was like, what? How'd you do that?
Well, we did it. I blasted it! There, that's how
Among
effective.
Other things. Doug was so
considering it was 10 CRs. Oh, no, wait. What? Because we were 15th level at the time?
I honestly don't
And we
remember.
Were using the Grazit's version out of the Codex of whatever.
I'm not the numbers guy in this
and
group.
And Grazit at the time was a CR 22. So he was 7 CRs above the party, which is supposed to be impossible. We destroyed that encounter without taking 1 point of damage out of our entire group, except for a couple of fodder people that we had along. But yeah.
Yes, I remember that, if I'm remembering correctly, maybe he'll come on later in a later podcast. We keep doing this and correct me. But Doug was so proud because he took down a Merilith in one round.
Oh, it was two-thirds of a round, remember?
Two-thirds of a round, okay.
Because he only did it, he had 12 attacks, and I think he did it in 8 attacks? He killed a Merilith in 8 attacks.
And again, yeah. I'm not the numbers guy. I'm the quote-unquote fluff guy. I'm the fluffer of the group, guys, okay?
But anyway, well, because I can remember exactly what was in the encounter. There was Grazit, who was CR-22. There was a Merilith, which is a CR-17. There was two... What are those big, ugly ones with the claws in their stomachs? That's sad. I don't remember that because, you know, I usually remember these things. But yeah.
I can't help you out,
there's CR-13s. There was 4 Lilitus, which at the time, I think, were CR-11s, which are basically your cleric healer types. And then a bunch of succubuses flying around.
Yeah.
So it was by far bigger than a CR-22 encounter.
To be fair, the rest of it, but I was paying attention to the Meriliths and especially the succubus, y'all. I want you to know that.
Well, weren't we all? We liked our women in that campaign, guys.
That's and a Gales. Whole other story for
yeah,
later
we,
on.
Yeah, we won't get into that. But yeah.
We'll probably bring up this campaign multiple times.
It was an evil campaign, people. Let's put it that way. So
I was playing my half-fiend bard, which was awesome. I had wings.
We liked elven girls. Let's put it that way.
Who doesn't?
Well, yeah. I was particularly fond of the drow chicks, so...
But anyway, it was nice knowing you guys. That's another thing with Doug.
Oh, yes.
It's nice knowing you guys.
Because he thought we were all going to die because we were level 15. And, well, there was level 15, but how many people in our party? There was 5 of us?
Well, there was...
Because there was Eric's character, there was my character,
yes,
your character,
right.
Doug, and Amanda's character.
And Amanda.
And then we had a...
We had
a Minotaur guy along with us, plus we had a Rage Drake. The Rage Drake's the one that took the amount of damage. But yeah.
Who was the Night Flutterer? I can only remember his title. I can't remember his real...
He was the little rat guy.
Yeah.
Who ends up, I don't know, Well, Eric at the time didn't realize this, but yeah, he was one of Grazit's former whatever things. But at the time, he was actually a god. We shouldn't have been using him. Okay. But yeah.
Well, we, you know, again, we make mistakes.
Can't remember what the guy's name. Well
even in whenever, we successfully finished the encounter, there was something we had brought up to Eric. It's like, if Grazit had done this, he could have screwed us all over. And Eric's excuse was well, I just didn't think Grazit, about it at the time.
Well, no, Grazit was that arrogant that he thought he had it handled, and he didn't do that.
Okay. Well, I guess that's a fair reason to.
Because remember, he called in, he used his telepathy to call in his Baylor minion that we had the door locked on. The Baylor got through the door. I turned around, flipped him off.
Yeah, and, I forgot that.
And I think that's when we called his demon prince ally in to help finish off Grazit or whatever. That's when he showed up.
Yeah.
And thank God, because that Baylor would have tore me a new one.
Well, I mean, all this to set up for you guys is like the craziness that I got into with our group was talking us into places like this.
That we would never ever get into, yeah.
Because
we had Grazit's daughter. That's
yes,
what it was.
I had actually charmed Grazit's daughter.
That's how we
Grazit's
got into
daughter.
See Grazit.
Yes, which was, I remember I felt so down at that point whenever we had gotten a hold of her. I actually convinced her.
Glacium? No, that's the different chick. Oh, no, God. Maybe it was Glacia. I don't know.
I can't think of it right now. But
I think it was Glass. Well, that's I can never remember because we haven't played
in any case,
for so long around that
we,
area. So.
We got through her to her chambers, persuaded my way in there with the party like we belonged, and I got her to
dominated
drop her defenses.
Yep.
I got to dominate her. I was playing a mindbender bard there as well. The only reason we could get it to work was her magical resistance was too high. So before I did anything, I bluffed and I asked her, would it be all right if I cast a beneficial spell on her? So Eric gave me the all clear on that. She drops her magical resistance.
Ha-ha, you're mine now. Yeah, because I think I was the one that suggested, because I was talking to you telepathically. You know?
Yes.
I said,
well, that's
don't do this, and then we did it.
One of the perks of the mindbender is that mental communication.
You had the telepathy also
so many times.
Mm-hmm.
And I could just let you guys know.
Which is a good thing, because like, they had all those shadow demons in the
yes,
in the floor.
But that's the whole thing. It's like, I thought, man, I'm worthless. I could, like, I was worse than a glass cannon. It's like, you could crush me in a blow, but I'm... Like,
well, you didn't design your character to do damage.
Well, it was I was down on myself because it's like I'm not really contributing to any of the fighting. And Eric like showed me, he's like, okay, all these shades hiding in the floor, and this and this and this trap is like, that's what you would have had to face if you hadn't talked your way in there more. So don't think you're worthless.
Yeah.
But whenever we faced Grazit, I had taken that Night Flutterer guy, and I remember we raided that wagon caravan to help cause discord and make him really upset, and I wrote in the dirt, fluttering in the night, F you, Grazit.
Just to get him all upset.
Just to get him riled.
Well, then remember, we talked to Orcus, and we had Orcus invade his lair at the same time, and because that's at the point I had, Eric's demon prince. I was telepathically bonded to him, plus yes. Orcus, so I could let him know when to come in. You know what I mean?
Yes. And I had to convince Orcus that it was a good idea to work with us because we were totally gonna manage to kill Grazit.
Because he wanted one of his, so we traded off a lair so he could.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, it's like you can have this lair if you help us do this, and all this leads up to beating Grazit and then meeting this Garistro afterward. And this big thing, upset with me because it was demanding tribute, and I didn't quite get. I'm like, oh no, we own you now. It's like, oh yeah, we beat Grazit, and Eric turns to me and says, Grazit is the most powerful thing he has ever known. That's completely beyond all his understanding to believe that you killed Grazit. You're not gonna convince him of that. So, like, he gave me that warning. I'm like, okay, how can I do this? It's like, oh, wait. No, you see, we own you now because Grazit traded with us for another layer of the Abyss, and it was a leverage buyout.
Pretty
what?
Much.
That was my favorite part. Was a what? a leverage buyout. You see, Grazit traded for more power, and in turn, we control you now. So then he tried to get tribute for us after that.
Well, because remember, because he had gems or something that we traded, like, shiny metal for, I think.
I think so. It's like gems, and Amanda had, like, we had these little tinfoil useless animal-shaped things.
Oh, that's what it was, yes.
And she had traded those for it. And, you know, he was pleased as punch to take them, so.
See, and that wasn't even my favorite part of that campaign. My favorite part was selling the essence of grass to the drow males so they could take over their drow females.
Well, we took the Grazit's ashes because we had like empty potion bottles at that stage, and I'm like, waste not, want not. I mean, how many times do you get a demon prince's ashes? Yeah. So we like mixed that with what? From the river Styx or something? From the
I don't know. We did something with it.
But the point is, anyway,
basically, we made oil of Grazit.
It wasn't enough for me to sell his ashes. I had to dilute them somehow to try and sell more of it.
Pretty much. It worked out, though, because, you know, the drows were going to go back and say, hey, we got this stuff that can, you know, protect us from the drow females, and we can take over now. And well, because that was the whole thing that, you know, I had my drow slaves, and they were women. It's like, see, it worked on them!
Yes.
So.
Yes, and I am a glorified snake oil salesman. That's how I play my evil persuasive
demon oil salesman, but
demon
yeah.
Demon oil.
It worked. It was great, honestly. It was fun.
Oh,
it was good times.
Yeah, good times had by all.
How can that's just our 3.5 stuff? That's not even, you know.
That's not even getting into the Pathfinder stuff yet. But yeah, then that brings me to another question that I know is always rough on me. Building a character, what sacrifices are you willing to make?
Well, it honestly depends on the character, honestly. You know what I mean?
True.
Because I start with a concept and I go from there. I don't go, oh, I'm going to take the most powerful this and the most powerful that. I take it what I think the character... I don't know. It's not... I develop a concept and I try to maximize my concept. So, you know, if I'm going to do an axe warrior, I, you know, pick stuff that's going to help me with the axe rather than... Or if I'm going to be a blaster, I pick stuff that's going to help the blasting. But I don't necessarily pick the most flavorful, most powerful option is what I try to do. But like I said, I try to stick into my concept. So if, like, fighters, I almost every character I ever play, I dump charisma, honestly.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of my characters don't use charisma in any sense of the word. Well, except for my most recent, which is an Arcanist, which I have a little bit of charisma. Which is, it's a 14, so it's a little, you know, well, I don't know, it's average, but...
No, I'm like the yin to your yang, or however that goes, because
yeah.
I know, like, for me, when I'm building characters, the charisma's got to be the highest. Well, depending, again,
well,
on
you,
what
you,
I'm
you
playing.
Like your bluff and your interaction-y skills.
Oh, and... I'm the most likable guy. How can you not like this guy? One of the things that I find liberating, whatever I was asking you about that, is that I find it liberating in the Bards is, like, particularly Demonic Campaign was
right.
The most so. Because I do not care what anybody thinks about me the next day.
Evil for one thing.
Yeah,
I just want
you to believe me for 2 seconds and do what I want, which is
then I get out of Dodge, yeah.
So the polar opposite of what reality is.
Well, that's the nice thing, is to play a character that you would never be in, you know. Well, I don't know. I'd make a good, well, except for not
the
being
one
able to
thing,
see what I'm shooting, but yeah.
The one thing that I would say definitely carries over into almost all my characters is that I don't like I'm not a sadist. I don't like to cause people pain. So even when I'm doing like an evil character like I did in Demonic Campaign, it's more along the lines of I'm going to manipulate the situation until... Great harm will come to you if you don't do what I want.
Mm-hmm.
But if you listen to me and you come with me and help me, you're going to be all right.
Exactly. Well, I get kind of squeamish even playing evil characters sometimes. Well, because I've played games like... particularly one that I can think of off the top of my head was we were playing, what the heck was it? It was a card game that they built off of Dragonlance.
Oh, I know the one you're talking about, but I can't think of what it was called.
Yeah. But anyways, we were playing, so I was, you know, I had a character built. I think I was playing like a Knight of Salamnia or something like that, and we were going through, and we ended up meeting Gully Dwarf somewhere, and everybody else just opens up on him and just murders the crap out of him. I'm like, I feel really squeamish about this, you know what I mean? I don't particularly like Gully Dwarves all that much, but I was a little upset. You know what I mean?
Well, branching out to that topic, that reminds me of a story in turn that I know you know. It was because one of the other things we did with Eric, or rather I did with Jeremy and Eric, was, again, we didn't have an established group at that point that we were playing D&D with, but we did Wheel of Time role-playing game. For those of you who are fans of Robert Jordan Wheel of Time, or those of you that don't know, as we discussed many times, it's a very, in my opinion, a well-written series, not in my favorite series, but it is so broad in scope and well done that I definitely recommend you check it out. Doesn't really get good, in my opinion, until like the third or so book.
See, I like second, but I think where it picks up. But end of the first book, it gets after that.
Gets rough, man. Whenever you get Matt getting super paranoid by the cursed dagger, that was a rough sequence for me. After that,
and that was cool. All the second book, pretty much. That's why you were.
That's why I'm hesitant there was to say the second book is good.
I like the second one. There was a lot of stuff going on. Not necessarily
the
you
first
know what I mean?
One, though. Absolutely, do not stop at the first one, because I got to the end
of it.
It
gets better, yeah.
And I had such a skewed view of the world that I'm like,
everybody's evil, and
yeah,
or at least everybody's annoying in this world.
They're evil, or at least slightly corrupt, and it's like that wasn't true.
No. Well, because the only thing you saw was, first off, you saw the Aes Sedai, which were basically manipulative bitches, if you think about it. Except for
women everywhere. But,
were. Moraine was okay. There was a couple Aes Sedai that were okay. Just
and that
not
was
all
the whole
of them.
Thing is like Moraine and Swan Sanche are really the only two that you know at that point, or I guess. Later in...
You don't even meet Swan.
We listened to the audiobooks, and then they changed their mind that she was Suan Sanche or something like that.
Not Swan, it's still Swan the whole
way. I remember there was
some
weirdness
there. I think
it was
Suan in the beginning, it was Swan
later. Right, you're right. But, no, it's like there are more good characters, you just hadn't been introduced to them at that point.
Yeah, basically, the main characters, which were all very young at that point, and mine and Morris's favorite character by far is Matt, but yeah, because he's just so crazy
and
for one thing. And
I mean, those of you that have read the series know probably why I like him is because I like to play scoundrel characters.
And
he
Matt
is
definitely a scoundrel. Yep. But we both agree that Perrin's our least favorite of the main character. Well, main male characters.
Which Jeremy incidentally said to me is like, oh, well, I thought you would like Perrin because he's so much like you. He's so noble.
Well, that's exactly
like,
why I don't
that's
like
exactly
him.
Why I don't like him, because it's so painful, dude. Like
he's okay, like in the last two books.
Yes.
But everything before that, he's like, "Oh my god, shut up!"
Oh,
and
man.
smack him upside the head, kind
of. His girl Fael, who you know,
there's
like,
another can of worms.
She
don't appreciate her at all, honestly.
I do, but my line was Fael is great. And
until
then
she talks,
and then she opens her mouth. Yes, because like she'd slap Perrin down all the time on these things, trying to get him to fight, because that's the background she comes from. And Perrin comes from this more, you know, easygoing, I need to respect all women country thing. He's like, oh, light, she can't want me to fight her. She can't want me to get angry. And, like, I'm listening to the audiobook, and I'm like, yes, that's what she wants!
Just do it already!
Show her you have a spine!
Yeah, but that's so annoying, though. I just...
Well, the thing about it that's so painful is, like, I can see myself in that character doing that exact same thing.
Yeah, well,
and to be there on the sidelines saying, it's like, stop doing it wrong.
First off, I wouldn't have put up with her to begin with, but yeah.
For some reason...
She's reasonably attractive sounding and all, but she would just drive me crazy. I'd want to... I don't know. I just want to strangle her eventually.
Her and all her relatives is like, I'm sorry, I'm actually kind of attracted to girls with bigger noses, so that doesn't do a thing to her. I don't mind
the bigger, nose thing.
I don't bother me either. But I'm getting to the personality too.
The attitude, like, yeah.
That's a bit much for me, yeah. And I'm not sure that I'd want a girl that would want to slap me that I'd have to you know...
Stand up to her.
Verbally, not physically, ladies and fellas. You know, it's like, give me a tongue lashing and then I'd have to smack her back. And, you know, I don't...
Well, she always wanted her backside smacked, too, if I remember correctly.
That's but, yeah. true, but, you know, that's like...
That's another whole kink I'm not willing to deal with either.
That's advice we can't give the folks at home. Don't do that, guys. It's too easy to screw up.
Not unless they ask for it, but yeah. Okay, some girls like the kinky stuff.
Have a safe word picked ahead of time.
Oh, exactly. Well, that's just... common sense right there.
Absolutely. Know your limits and know your partner's limits. But no, like, I for all that, I mean, like, Nynaeve would probably be a better character. Nynaeve,
yeah, I
is
like Nynaeve.
Another, like, she's,
I hated her in the beginning, loved her in the end, you
she's
know what I mean?
Tough as nails. Like, it's one of the things that she softens up in the long run.
Well, once she meets a man that actually likes her back and, you know, respects her and treats her like, you know, like an equal, she, you know what I mean? She loosens up a lot.
Yeah, but that's like, I can appreciate that. And that, to the extent that she was like that, I can appreciate that in Faile, is like, loyalty goes a long way with me. You know what I mean? But anyway, getting back to our story. Boy, this is going to be a long-winded podcast.
Yeah, it's sure as heck. It's a lot longer than I expected to be, honestly. But yeah, it's all good.
Jeremy wanted to play an Ogier.
Yeah. Oh,
God, which,
yeah.
Ogiers, those of you who don't know, are not at all like ogres. They are not violent creatures. They are peaceful creatures. And he was obsessed with sung wood, which is a special ability some Ogier have, that they can sing to trees and cause
them to create things out of
yeah,
the,
with these
the
special
wood
pieces
from the trees.
Of wood. I think it rivals steel, does it not?
So, if it's exactly as strong as steel, but it's pretty, it's tougher than normal wood. Let's put it that way.
But he's obsessing over this, but he wants to be kind of a bloodthirsty Ogier, which doesn't work. And
not unless you're a Sean Chen Ogier, which didn't show up until
later.
And I
still argue with him about that.
And they're not really necessarily bloodthirsty. They're just, you know what I mean? Because they're just guards and stuff. You never showed
them. Kind of more duty-bound, but
yeah.
Regardless.
More like Ogier used to be, actually. Because Ogier were a foe to behold, and you know, kind of thing.
Yeah,
you know
that's
I mean?
True. But that's like in the Shadow
well,
War
yeah,
type stuff. But
yeah, that's way...
Anyway, he decides that...
Neither here nor there.
He wants to play an Ogier, but he was getting really bored really easily.
Because he wanted to go through the ways, I remember that. Idiot.
Oh, God. You're right. I forgot to mention that. It's like the ways, the darkened wasteland that nobody should go through, that there's the Monchin Shin mist that will tear you apart and corrupt you forever. Yeah, let's go through there, guys. And
like, that won't end in bad results.
So I've got, at this point, I've not read the series at all. And I've got Eric explaining this stuff to me. And he's explaining how bad the ways is. And my character has no in-character knowledge of this. But the whole time, I'm like, this is a bad idea. And I picked up blood and bloody ashes, their swear words in that setting, pretty quick. So we had gone through the ways. And
Flaming Goat Kisser.
Flaming Goat Kissers. I didn't find out about that until going through
yeah,
the book.
Actually, I probably read
it. I appreciate
Uno,
that.
Uno, thank you.
it almost works in every day.
Yeah, it does.
But anyway, we had gone through the ways and done this, that, and the other thing. And eventually, I made a completely different kind of character for this, where I was a woodsman, you know, kind of their version of a ranger. And I made this guy, instead of being persuasive or anything, he was basically a good-hearted guy who was obsessed with food. And that was my whole thing. So Jeremy decides he's getting bored with the campaign that Eric has set out for us. We come across tinkers, which are...
Pacifists.
Pacifists wear bright colors. They mend pots for people. The only thing that will protect them is their big guard dogs.
Basically pacifist Romani, kinda.
Yeah. They'll run from you before they're gonna take a swing at you, okay? He decides, after we had eaten with these people, we broke bread, for Christ's sake. He's going to go back and light their tents on fire and slaughter some. So he leads
Eric... This is an ogier, by the way.
Yes. Another pacifist, an ogier. He leads us out into the woods. My woodsman and Eric was playing a channel. And
male channeler, I believe, right?
Male channeler, and that's actually one of the oddities was that we, you know, in characters, like, he didn't accept it because I was an aloof type of character. I didn't care. So long as he got me food at the end of the day, we can still be buddies. So, I was a wolf brother, by the way, those of you who know what that means. And my whole goal was, if I couldn't pair with the wolves to be like them without going crazy, I was going to pee on Jeremy's shoe. That was my goal.
He deserved a shoe peed on.
So he leads us out into the woods and leaves us there in the dark, saying he's got to take care of something, which was a flimsy excuse, and then goes back to set the tents on fire. And I decide I'm going to follow him back. Yeah.
He gets suspicious. Like,
he's like, there's no way you could follow me. It's like,
I'm a woodsman.
I'm a woodsman. I can follow you back. Furthermore, their cook pots are still going, and I can find food. Try me. I would have rolled for, you know, chance to find it if Eric would have asked for it. So I follow him back, see him setting a tent ablaze, and I draw my sword. And he's, oh no. Oh no. Well, I have more HP than he does. And Eric goes, yes, but he has a higher armor class than you do. Oh, no. Oh, no. Guys, can we pretend this never happened?
Basically, Jeremy was a type of person that was disruptive on purpose. One of those characters everybody loves to hate. Because he does it in every campaign.
I don't know if it's fair to say every campaign, but definitely every
most
time
of the
you've
ones
ever
I ever heard of that was the case. I'm glad I've never played in one with him. Let's put it that way, because my character would definitely murder his character, because and wouldn't even feel bad about it. Well, because I want to be in the tent with the old woman, stuff like that. I don't, you know.
That's just the Diablo 2 based campaign that Eric made for funsies. Like, he kept working on Diablo 2 campaigns. He loved that series. He loved that game specifically for the series. And like,
and he had the core book for it.
Building,
so.
Yeah. But he kept insisting that he wanted to be alone with the female quest giver, who's like an old witch lady, because he wanted to basically guilt her into having to come and help us with our quest.
But the way he said things, it was...
Well,
think of the perviest thing you could possibly think of, and that's what happened.
To be fair, I was the one who was harassing him. Was like,
I know,
no, I'm not going to leave you alone in the tent with the old woman, you perv.
Well, but that's what I'm saying. But the way he said things, it just... Because he'd tell me about... Every once in a while, he'd tell me about, oh, we did this, whatever. I'm like,
You weren't the one who had to sit there for the Wheel of Time, same ogier, by the way, where he's intimately describing how he's rocking the bed in the room. As, dude!
With who? I don't even remember.
With his imaginary ogier wife that he pretended that he had so he could get Eric to say, oh, fine, we go back to a steading and you found your wife. Just so we could talk about that. I mean, I at least had some class, whereas I just said I took the young maid to my bedchamber and left it at that, and then idiot decides
he's
going to come around.
The whole thing.
No, it wasn't even that. It was that this came after having to put up with his description. Did I have my fun with a girl who was more than willing, by the way, and he decides he's going to burst into my bedchambers.
For what?
Because reasons. I think he thought it was funny.
But oh, yeah, that's funny.
At that point, is like, hey, ladies, I have to defend this girl's honor. Was kind of where I decided to be coming from. And I'm like, I draw my sword and meet him at the door with it. It's like, if you open this door, I'm going to cut your head off.
Well, that's what I do in real life, probably, so yeah.
Man.
let's get off this before I want to strangle
yes,
more.
Well, something that I think we skipped over, I forgot to get in the order of questions on this page.
Order smarter.
Yeah, we loose and fast, that's how we roll. How do you play Wall Blind?
Very creatively. Actually, I have a program that's called Jaws, which basically reads stuff off the screen. I use PDFs. I am the dungeon master, by the way.
Sometimes you're
game
master.
Yeah. More often than not, game master anymore, because he has Pathfinder.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I also have a lot of help from my friends. I like Boris here. He's usually my map reader for me, so it's like, hey, you're in this room, and he tells, well, there's a door out here, and there's a door out. Well, okay, which way you guys want to go, basically.
I like to have a copy of the PDF on hand that, like, I can help him along, and if he's like, okay, read off this description or that.
Go to A13 and read the description of the room for me.
Yeah, I know what you guys are thinking. I try super hard not to metagame, or if I accidentally read something I'm not supposed to know, I let everybody else make their group decision before I weigh in on anything.
Mm-hmm.
And I try to do a lot of
and you also try to do it the way your character would do it anyway, so.
Well, that's something that super frustrates me about other people. It's like, it's Knights of the Old Republic, but I remember this being a thing. It's like, at some point, your character's gonna look goofy because of all the stat bonuses that you get from X item that you found. It's like, no! No! If I look like I'm, wearing neon socks in the dark, I'm not dressing like that. Mm-hmm. I'm not an idiot.
Well, because I remember you not liking ion stones because they're floating around your head, so you wouldn't take them.
Yeah.
So, hey.
And there's someone at home going, you're an idiot. I'm like, no, you're the idiot.
Well, it's like me. I'm a straight up, hetero male, and I'm not going to wear a pink skirt. It's just not going to happen.
Not
no matter what kind of stat bonus
that.
It gives me.
Not that there's anything wrong with it.
No matter how good my ass looks in it, I ain't wearing it.
Well, if I were playing a character that didn't give a crap. And,
that's what I'm saying. If it was my character concept, but that's, if I was a character, I would not wear a pink skirt or pink boots or pink, earrings or, any of that kind of
thing. Well, again, about the sacrifices when you're making characters, I can't stand low intelligence on a character.
I can't either.
I gotta, even when it's useless to my character, I want him to be smart, which is part of the problem whenever it comes to, usually what
suffers... Out of all my, mental scores, that's the one that I do not skimp on. I don't take less than a 10 in wisdom either, but yeah.
Yeah. Well, I actually tend to value wisdom higher than I do intelligence in characters, because of my own personal real life is like, I don't feel like I'm a real intelligent guy. I don't feel like I can analyze things and know the answer.
Right.
But a lot of the knowledge that I get is from past experience, and I'm able to use that to weigh against a situation.
Which, is more of a wisdom kind of thing, I suppose. Yeah.
But I usually, whenever I'm rolling a character, strength is going to be the thing that suffers the most, hands down.
You tend to do more ranged characters, ranged bars, than anything else, too.
Yeah, then mostly because I can't get up in their face
or
cause finessable, the problem the way
or something you finesse with, too.
Yeah, so dex is typically high, and then con is as low as I can afford it to be.
See, I never really min-max anything. I try to keep... Well, I play a wizard. I don't go, I'm going to blow and throw everything, all my, physical and all my other ability scores out the window so I can have a super high intelligence. I don't do that. I think that's ridiculous.
There actually was a time where we were doing, I think it was Jade Regent that we had played all together on Pathfinder, that, I had a Dampier character who had a low con score. And that actually was something that I built into part of the character. Is he had been really sickly, and the townsfolk had helped save him was in my backstory on
that. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
So I'm being the fluff guy. I care more about the story and where it's going and interactions than I do about I got the most numbers.
Yeah, I don't really. Well, I like to have high numbers as much as the next guy, but it's not that's not what I focus on.
Hmm.
Well, like a wizard, like I said, I don't start with a 22 intelligence and have 7 everywhere else. I like to be pretty hardy, so I like to have a decent con, and I like to have a different dex. And after that, I kind of just throw it where it comes into, you know what I mean? Well, to be fair, we also start with a pretty high point buy when we play too, so we can afford to put points.
But it's like I like having the high point buy. Typically, you throw templates on stuff, don't you, to try and make it more of a challenge?
I just beef up the monsters to make. I just don't like seeing always low number, because the elite stat array is crap. You know what I mean? It's just, oh, I have an 8, because, you know, I hate anything below a 10. Because if you're not at least average, what the heck's the point?
Yeah.
I'm below average in at least one stat, because that's the way the game says it should be. I think that's ridiculous.
That's why we're playing the game, folks. We want to be exceptional.
Well, you want to feel like a hero. I mean, that's the whole idea as far as I'm concerned. Mm. And we don't do rolling. We do stat point buys. Simply because it keeps everybody relatively even. Without, you know, hey, I'm a super, super effective guy. Well, I'm the guy with, you know, 12s across the board, you know what I mean?
Yeah. And usually whenever we're gaming, is like, I like to have the PDF so I can be the guy who's able to read stuff off for you and help you find, like, okay, we're going to encounter this in this room.
And you never know what it is anyways, because a lot of times I change stuff, so.
That's true.
Well, here's a super DM tip for people. Modify the adventures to suit your player characters. Otherwise, they'll just steamroll over everything.
Absolutely. And I mean, like, even in the case of people, they complain about things that seem to me that, like, it's GM has final say for a reason. Like,
rule zero.
If you talk with your PCs and, like, the PCs, like, I kind of like this to be a part of the story, and you don't see a problem with that, why not let them do it?
Well, it's like, especially with me, everybody knows what I like to do with my character, so they know exactly, you know, they know what to expect from me, because I let anybody use whatever book they want, whatever feat, whatever, and unless it becomes a problem, then I get rid of it. Or, like, can you please tone that back?
Yeah.
Or whatever. Yeah, I mean, my friend Doug, he likes playing, you know, knight/paladin type characters. I don't think he's ever played a paladin in anything I do, because, you know, I pretty hardcore slam people if they do something stupid as a paladin.
Not in anything you've done that I can remember, anyway. But
he's playing, called a Guardian, which is,
which is
Dreams Car Press. It's the Path of War stuff. And it's an interesting character. It's not too powerful yet, but he's also picked stuff that wasn't over the top crazy.
Yeah, he's toned it back a little bit from what he could have, but still, he's kicking ass and taking names.
He usually does. Well, Doug's whole thing is he likes to make the most invulnerable character possible.
Mm-hmm.
And he always gets upset when I whack him with something. You know what I mean? I was like, oh, crap. I need to raise my armor class a little higher. I was like, Doug, I had to roll an 18 to hit you with that. You know what I mean?
But yeah, and Doug typically, whenever we're gaming, he's like, I like to read out the descriptions whenever you want. He likes to basically be the map guy, where, like, he is keeping track of which rooms we visited to make sure we maximize the amount of...
Yeah, because we're completionists. We like to hit everything. Yeah. So.
Oh, man. Something that, like...
He's also our treasure keeper, so...
I don't know if this is...
He's an accountant by trade, so, yeah, he likes numbers.
Which is so weird to me.
I know.
It's like you go to work, you're crunching numbers all day. Let me go home and relax and crunch some more numbers.
Yeah, but the numbers he's crunching at home, it's the money he's raking in rather than what he's paying out as his accounting job. But it's still... I always thought that was amusing to me, too.
He'll always go, money!
Yeah. Well, what I always found funny, too, when we first started playing, and he first started taking, because he was, you know, taking accounting classes and doing all this stuff, and he's calculating all this stuff out, and I was like, why are you doing, why don't you sit, and he goes, wow, that would be much easier. I'm like, oh my god, you're the accountant, I'm the blind guy that doesn't know numbers worth crap.
I wish, though, that I had his obsessive organization skills.
Oh, God, he's so good at
organizing. This is one of the few people that I have ever heard of who has
a spreadsheet
that he can follow this flow chart for. This is the best damage to do in this situation. This will maximize my potential.
I mean, it kind of makes sense if you were a real character. You would understand that already without having to look at a spreadsheet. But you know what I mean? It's
yeah,
like,
yeah, I suppose that's fair. I never really thought of it that way.
Well, but see, I just automatically calculate that stuff in my head. I don't need to, you know what I mean?
Well, usually with the character that I'm playing, if I'm talking to you is the first resort, fighting you is the last resort. Mm-hmm. And usually I'm not putting enough into my attack that it's like, okay, I better just wallop them the best I can and hope.
Well, you usually try to do something creative with a spell most of the time also, you know what I mean?
Oh, man, there was that one time that blindness, deafness was my friend.
That worked really well.
That was my friend.
Even out of a wand, it was working pretty well.
Yeah, until we started running stuff that was way too high
level.
Well,
yeah, it was, yeah. But it worked. Hey, anybody can still fail. It's hard. You know, once you get to a certain point, it's a lot.
Hey, kids, when you don't know if you're going to be able to hit them in the first place, and they've still got a percentage of...
What the hell?
Failing, you know, doing a critical failure, go for it. Because that actually worked that one
Sometimes
time.
Those are some of the most satisfying. It's like, yes, it worked!
Yes, but then the problem is it's like you keep hoping that's going to happen
work
all
again,
the time.
And it works that first time, and it's like the next 10 times it doesn't do a damn thing. And you're like, shit.
But what was that, I can't think of the creature name. It was not Chimera, but like a lion type creature we were facing.
Oh, the one was the ones that shoots the spikes out of their tail. Aw, crap.
Yeah, I know. I can't think of it either. But regardless, it's flying through the air.
I can picture it in even my
head.
Yes,
so can I.
One,
but I, it's flying
manticore.
Through the air. Manticore, thank you.
Yes.
The manticore's flying through the air. We're on a ship.
This is Skulls and Shackles, by the way.
I'm going for Broken Skulls and Shackles. Yeah, I point the wand. I think I'd used a wand at it instead of trying to cast it from my spell list.
Yeah,
you
used a wand.
And... it critical fails. It's like, okay, he's blind now.
So it sits flying in the air, flies off out in the middle of nowhere, not knowing where it's going because it couldn't land anywhere and get healed because it couldn't even see where it was at. And we're over open water because it leaped off another ship, I think.
Yeah, and it was up in the air trying to dive bomb us with its tail spikes.
It kept flying up us and firing its tail spikes at us.
Good
as
stuff.
It basically is a distraction trying to slow us down as the other ship's coming up on us.
Oh, another thing that I think might be important and mentioned for the folks is marching order, like how that works in our group. I don't think that's that foreign of a concept.
Oh, no, everybody does that, but we almost always do the same marching order, no matter, because I'm always in the middle because I'm usually a squishy.
Because while we are gaming with a map, we virtually never do tabletop because that requires paper, which costs money.
Well, we also probably ought to mention our current group at the time because which is I'm a DM. I'm also a DM player. Nobody seems to have a problem with me because I don't go out of my way to overshadow anybody, and I don't try to be the be the star, and I don't talk to myself in character because that's just ridiculous. But yeah. So there's me. Currently we're in playing Shattered Star. I'm playing an Arcanist. Can't remember what his name is right now. Because we haven't played in a few months now.
Yeah.
Because Xandramus is what my character's name is. If anybody knows fantasy novels out there, that you'd probably recognize that character out of a novel. But yeah. And there's me. And there's Doug's character, which I cannot remember what his name is either off the top of my head because I don't have my notes handy.
You're the one who bit this one off, so I'm not even going to try.
He's playing the Guardian, and then you got your character who is a Mesmerist. I don't remember what your character's name is, do you?
Yeah, I wanted to try something new, so they suggested try Mesmerist. That's kind of along your lines. I believe... I don't know for sure without finding my character sheet, but I think I named this guy Rahab, something along that line.
Something like that.
But
yeah.
For those of you who might have maybe caught that name, it's like, that sounds familiar. I'm a big fan of the Legacy of Kain video game series. So typically, I will name my characters off of something Legacy of Kain related as kind of like an inside thing for me. Sometimes on rare occasions, like there was that cat character I was playing for Skulls and Shackles. Yes, I was a cat on a boat. That was Sathra, who was based off of Saathra or something along those lines. It was an Elder Scrolls character from Redguard. Because I just like the idea of the talking cat sailor.
And then, and then we have Kay, who is our friend Eric. He's
Yes,
Eric
our
with a
other
K.
Eric friend with a K instead of a C.
So he's just K because it's too hard to remember everything else. And then our friend Rob, who joined us later in the campaign, and he's okay. Kay's playing a crossbow ace, by the way. And then female, by the way. And then Rob, who is playing a musket master gunslinger, so.
Which Kay occasionally I've thought about teasing him as far as like should I hit on his character? She doesn't seem
That just
unattractive,
seems
and
weird to me, but
it seems weird, and it's also the whole thing is like in case that I will shoot you. It's like yes, and I respect that.
I will shoot you in the face. But well, we adventure. We don't, adventure to date each other, so,
That's true. It's like, well, yeah, there's always another port, another girl in said port. Chances are you'll hit it off with someone.
Well, come to think of it, I think we're in part three of that one. I was thinking we were in part two, but we're like eighth level, so we have to be in part three.
It's been a while since we've been
We're in
able
the
to
beginning
game,
of part
so.
three. We just went into, I want to call it Mos Eisley, but that's not the place. But yeah.
Oh yes, that is it. Underground city.
Not under, it's on the top, it's on the edge of a cliff, but you have to go up through the underground to get to the top,
So
which
that's
is
yeah.
Karamaga is where we're at the moment.
But yeah, we're
Because we just did the whole, oh, that's where we're at. We're down in the under, we started going back down underground because we went through the library. And we were down in that, remember that angel, no, the coatl that was summoned, there to attack us, and we
Yes.
couldn't, yes, that was where we
That's
left
right
off.
where we left off, yes.
Oh, spoiler alert. But yeah. Probably should have said that first.
Gotta go back, edit this. It's like, spoiler alert, kids.
Nah, they'll survive.
I don't think we gave away anything
No.
that,
Knowing there's a coatl there, but yeah, that's doesn't
yeah.
really.
Get all your Quaddle Bane weapons. So, yeah, I now need to ask, like, what is the thing, Mike, for you? Because I know what this is for me, but what keeps you playing this game? Like, what's the
Well, for me,
Pathfinder
I
pull?
enjoyed getting just hanging out with my friends on online and playing. I mean, that's especially for me because I can't just jump in my car and drive anywhere anymore because I've been, oh, by the way, I've been blind for 15 years, so originally when I started playing I could see. And this is one of the few hobbies I can actually still do that's you know what I mean without without a whole lot of extra crap I have to go through to do it. I mean, we don't play with minis because what's the point? We're also kind of all poor. Well, we're not poor, but we don't have millions of dollars to spend on a case of minis every time they come out.
It'd be nice, don't get me wrong, and if
Oh,
somebody wants to
yeah.
send us those millions of dollars.
Well, heck, I'd like to be able to, because they do maps and stuff online where you can, move your character
Yeah,
and blah, blah,
I've seen
blah.
some of these
Some of the mapping tools and,
tabletop
yeah, some
simulators
of the
are very
tabletop
interesting.
simulators are pretty advanced now, but I
Oh
wouldn't be able
yeah,
to
I
run
saw
that.
one where it's you
Roll
could
20
roll
is
your own
one.
dice, yeah, and it's oh man.
And actually, Pathfinder has just recently signed a contract with some of those guys that you can get the maps and stuff right on there. So,
Nice.
and you can, it's they, just developed to actually play on those with the Pathfinder stuff. So they have the high quality, maps and everything on there. Which, from what I understand, that's a pretty cool thing. So people check that out if you're interested.
Yeah, it looks really cool. If I had a whole lot of disposable income right now, I might think about it. But it's one of those things, is like, you don't necessarily even need that to enjoy the game.
There's another, look, it'd be great for all of us to be able to get together and play it at somebody's house, at the, mm-hmm. you know, play with the table and, you know,
with minis and all that stuff. And infinite money.
There's another program that I really like that doesn't work so well over Skype, which is called Sirenscape, which they do a lot of sound packs and stuff for the different adventures. Yeah. And some of it's just really awesome. I just really wish I could play it. Or use it, or blow it through Skype, or whatever. Even if I could do it, throw it through Skype.
That's another thing we didn't mention, Mike, was how you handle dice. Because, I mean, sometimes you'll have one of us just roll for you, because that's easy.
Well, I roll all the D20 stuff. And then usually I have Doug roll damage, or whoever's available at the time. Like, if Doug's running off with his kids or whatever. But I rolled a hit, and they roll the dice, or I roll saving throws, or I roll... You know, that sort of thing.
Yeah, and you'll, like, use a number generator as opposed to, you know, actually rolling physical dice.
Yeah, the program I use, it's Red Dragon Inn, a dice roller. I kind of like that one. It's very simple. It's very easy. But it only rolls one type of dice at a time, which I wish actually would give you some multiple functionality in there, because that'd be awesome, because then I wouldn't have to ask everybody else to roll.
You hear that, Red Dragon will give you another plug if you add that feature.
Yeah, there you go. Because like I said, it's a great dice roll. It's very useful. It's just, it's kind of limited, but it's very simple, though. It's really easy for me to use. It's easy for me to navigate is the main thing. Because if it's everything's all wonky where it's hard to navigate, it doesn't do me any good.
Yeah, and something that really works with your screen reader, like typically Jaws. Graphical things don't work with Jaws for you, I notice.
Not very well. I mean, they're starting to add more of that type of functionality into the program. But as fast as they put new versions out, it's ridiculous trying to learn the new stuff every time they put it. You know what I mean?
Because
they have, like, you can read graphical, like, sometimes you can read graphics with it now.
Yeah.
But I still haven't learned how to do that yet. And frankly, I'm fine not learning how to do that because, you know.
More work for you.
Well, it's just hard to try to keep everything straight in your head without, you know.
Mm.
It's hard enough keeping up with the normal stuff, let alone, you know what I mean? I mean, I learn new things and faster things to do ways, you know, things every day. It's just, you know, every so often I was like, wow, that's a lot easier than the way I was doing it. But, yeah.
That's one of the fun things, like, mostly for video games for me, but also sometimes for these Pathfinder games, is somebody will tell me, or... You'll be watching somebody play the game. It's like, I didn't know you could do that. Why didn't I figure out you could do that?
Well, it's like me. I mean, I have a lot of stuff. So I trying to keep all my Pathfinder stuff straight in my head is hard enough as it is. You know what I mean? Because I read every book that comes out. The only thing I never buy is map packs. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Simply because they don't do any good, because I can't see them.
Because I'm the guy, or Doug's the guy, who's got to read the map pack off for him. So, like, that's
not going to help. Well, if it comes with a map already, that's one thing. But, you know what I mean? I don't go, I need the map pack for Strange Aeons, or Aeon, whatever the hell it is. But
I think you can pronounce it either way. I mean...
I think it's Aeon. Strange Aeon. Strange Aeons, the way...
English majors and linguists, help us out.
Well, see, I pronounce things the way, because my computer talks to me, so if it pronounces, yeah, it pronounces.
Exactly.
You know, exactly. So if it pronounces it that way, I will pronounce it that way since.
Yeah, we had found
unless
out.
Unless I'm listening to something, you know, like James Jacobs is talking about, or like on a podcast or whatever, and he actually pronounces it the correct way, then I go through... Because it has like a dictionary thing where you can have it pronounce things. You know, you can go through and change the pronunciation way things are pronounced. Well, like one of the first things that drove me crazy was, okay, battle axe came up as battley axe because it's all one word. So you had to go through and change it to make it so it sounded like two words. So battley axe, yeah, that drove me crazy. And there was a couple other things similar to that.
Yeah, Battley Axe
was one of the big ones that I remember was Battley Axe. And I'm like, oh my God.
Well, you run into that, and then foreign words like French, Spanish, you know.
Actually, I could get my computer to pronounce that correctly if I wanted to. I just don't bother. You know what I mean? Well, because the main because JAWS gives you a choice. Your primary language. Okay, American English, which is my primary language. But then it has secondary language, so you could change that. So if you're getting a lot of Spanish with your stuff, then you can change it to Spanish and it'll pronounce it the way the Spanish word is pronounced. But I screw that. You know?
No es bueno.
If it says perro, I know it's a dog, you know? Because I'm not going to try to roll out R's because I never could do that, even though I've had millions of years of Spanish. French words are the ones I really have problems with. Well, that and there's some really weird German words, but yeah.
That being neither here nor there.
Yeah. But you don't really get a lot of that in Pathfinder, so you know what I mean? Occasionally you'll get a foreign word that has some common usage in American or, you know, English or whatnot, but you know.
Yeah.
Okay, heck, I don't even know all the English words. Sometimes I have to look the definitions for those up. So
I'm so bad with pronunciation keys, it's not even funny.
It's hard,
and
yeah.
There's times that we'll be gaming that Kale goes, it's pronounced this way, actually. It's like, thank you.
Yep.
Thank you for helping me instead of just letting me fumble for another hour with this.
Kay's very good with that. He's a very articulate dude, though, so. I have trouble pronouncing things, and, you know. even if I know how to pronounce it, sometimes I fumble over it, you know what I mean?
That'll happen. Shared experience, I would think.
Yeah. It's just I'm used to it, and it's like, well, it's a typical word that you don't hear a lot. It's, you know what I mean?
So, just because...
Right.
I gotta mention some of the times I've had fun reading, particularly for college assignments. French words, what were you thinking, French? Mm-hmm. Like, there was a time where I was doing it was actually a history of Japan and China book, and they were talking about the Burgoys. I'm like, the Burgoys? Bourgeoisie, I'm an idiot.
I was just going to say, what?
One cannot wine and dine with the Burgoys. You can't race in a Grand Prix.
Sure you can.
So I think that brings us about to an end of our first character creation podcast of Blind Sense. Hopefully you guys have a bit of a better idea for who we are and what we're about and eventually where we'll get this podcast to on Pathfinder. For your contact, Mike, you're on the Paizo forums.
I'm on the Paizo forums. I guess, what the heck would I call that? My
screen name?
Yeah, my screen name. My acronym on there was Valantrix1, number one.
You might want to spell that for them, because I know
okay.
I can.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Valantrix. X as in sex. Okay. Sorry, had to do that.
And that's the note we're ending on. So
had to do that.
Thanks, everybody, for listening this far. I'll also add in here at the end, if we have an email up and going for this podcast, we'll also possibly take messages from you there. Any questions you might have, comments, concerns.
That's a good point. If you want to hit me on my email, valantrix@gmail.com.
Okay, there we go. That's what we'll set up, valantrix@gmail.com as well. Thanks for listening to the Blind Sense Podcast. This is Morris signing out.
And Mike. Later.
The theme music used for this podcast, Orc March by Snowflake, featuring Wolf Sebastian and Spinning Merkaba, is available from CC Mixter under the Creative Commons Attribution 3.0 license. You can find it at dig.ccmixter.org, or find a direct link to it and its license information in our Blind Sense podcast descriptions on either YouTube or SoundCloud.com. You can also give us something more to talk about next time, or talk with Mike about your best wizard build, by emailing valantrix@gmail.com. That's Valantrix, spelled V-A-L-A-N-T-R-I-X. Thank you.